There Was Light, the autobiography of Jacques Lusseyran. As I remember it, my story starts out like a fairy tale. Not an unusual one, but still a fairy tale. Once upon a time in Paris, between two world wars, there lived a happy little boy. I was that little boy, and today when I look back at him from the midpoint of life which I have reached, I marvel. A happy childhood is so rare. I was born in 1924, on September 19th at noon, in the heart of Paris in Montmartre, between the Place Blanche and the Moulin Rouge. I was born in a modest 19th century house, in a room looking out over a courtyard. My parents were protection, confidence, warmth. When I think of my childhood, I still feel the sense of warmth above me, behind, and around me. That marvelous sense of living not yet on one's own, but leaning body and soul on others who accept the charge. My parents carried me along, and that, I am sure, is the reason why through all my childhood I never touched ground. I could go away and come back. Objects had no weight, and I never became entangled in the web of things. I passed between dangers and fears as light passes through a mirror. That was the joy of my childhood. The magic armor, which once put on, protects for a lifetime. My parents were heaven. I didn't say this to myself so precisely, and they never said it to me, but it was obvious. I knew very early, I'm quite sure of it, that through them, another being concerned himself with me and even addressed himself to me. This other, I did not even call God. My parents spoke to me about God, but only later. I had no name for him. He was just there, and it was better so. Behind my parents, there was someone, and my father and mother were simply the people responsible for passing along the gift. My religion began like this, which I think explains why I have never known doubt. This confession may be something of a surprise, but I set store by it because it will make so many other things clear. My recklessness, for instance. For 7 years, I jumped, I ran, I covered the paths of the Champ de Mars. I scoured the sidewalks of the narrow Paris streets where the houses were crowded into the fragrant thoroughfares. I felt sure that nothing was unfriendly, that the branches I used to swing on would hold firm, and that the paths, no matter how winding, would take me to a place where I would not be afraid, that all paths eventually would lead me back to my family. You might say that I had no story, except the most important of all, the story of life. Still, there was light, and light cast a spell over me. I saw it everywhere I went and watched it by the hour. This light was not like the flow of water, but something more fleeting and numberless, for its source was everywhere. I liked seeing that the light came from nowhere in particular, but was an element, just like air. We never ask ourselves where air comes from, for it is there, and we are alive. With the sun, it is the same thing. I looked for it in the flickering of its beams, in the echo which, as a rule, we attribute only to sound, but which belongs to light in the same measure. Radiance multiplied, reflecting itself from one window to the next, from a fragment of wall to cloud above. It entered into me, became part of me. I was eating sun. This fascination did not stop when night fell. When I came in from outdoors in the evening, when supper was over, I found the fascination again in the dark. Darkness for me was still light, but in a new form and a new rhythm. It was light at a slower pace. In other words, nothing in the world, not even what I saw inside myself with closed eyelids, was outside this great miracle of light. Whenever I ran across the Champ de Mars, I was still chasing light. I was just about to jump into it with my feet together at the end of the path to catch hold of it as you catch a butterfly over the pond, to lie down with it in the grass or on the sand. Nothing else in nature, not even the sounds to which I listened so attentively, was as precious to me as light. When I was about 4 or 5 years old, I suddenly discovered that you can hold light in your hands. To do this, you only need to take colored crayons or blocks and play with them. I began to spend hours doing all kinds of coloring, without much form, I'm sure, but I kept diving in as you plunge into a fountain. My eyes are still filled with those colors. They told me later that even at this early age, I had poor sight. Myopia, I think it was, a condition which positive people would think quite adequate to explain my obsession. But as a young child, I was not aware that I did not see very well. I was not concerned about it because I was happy to make friends with light as though it were the essence of the whole world. Colors, shapes, even objects, the heaviest of them, all had the same vibration. And today, every time I assume the attitude of tender attention, I find the same vibration once again. I am certain that children always know more than they are able to tell, and that makes a big difference between them and adults who, at best, know only a fraction of what they say. The reason is simply that children know everything with their whole beings, while we know it only with our heads. When a child is threatened by sickness or trouble, he knows it right away, stops his games, and takes refuge with his mother. In just this way, when I was 7 years old, I realized that fate had a blow in store for me. It happened in the Easter holidays in Juvaldais, a little village in the Anjou where my maternal grandparents lived. We were about to go back to Paris, and the buggy was already at the door to take us to the station. As the buggy was waiting and jingling its bells, I'd stayed behind in the garden, by the corner of the barn, alone and in tears. These are not the kind of tears they tell you about later, for I still feel them deeply whenever I think of them. I was crying because I was looking at the garden for the last time. I just learned the bad news. I couldn't say how, but there was absolutely no doubt. Sunlight on the paths, the two great box trees, the grape arbor, the rows of tomatoes, cucumbers, and beans, all the familiar sights which had peopled my eyes, I was seeing for the last time. And I was aware of it. This was much more than childish sorrow. And when my mother, after looking for me, finally found me and asked me what the trouble was, I could only say, I am never going to see the garden again. 3 weeks later, it came about. On the 3rd of May, I was at school as usual. At 10 o'clock, I jumped up with my classmates who were running for the door to the playground outside. In the scuffle, an older boy who was in a hurry came up from the back of the room and ran into me accidentally from behind. I hadn't seen him coming, and taken off guard, lost my balance and fell. As I fell, I struck one of the sharp corners of the teacher's desk. I was wearing glasses because they had discovered I was nearsighted. The glasses were made of shatterproof glass, and it was just this precaution that was my undoing. The lenses did not break, but the blow was so violent that one arm of the spectacles went deep into the tissue of the right eye and tore it away. I lost consciousness, but came to immediately after being carried to the school playground. The first thing that occurred to me, I remember vividly, was, my eyes. Where are my eyes? I could hear frightened people around me talking in panic about my eyes, but even without the voices and the pain, I should have known where I had been hit. They bandaged me up and took me home with fever raging through my body. There, everything blacked out for more than 24 hours. I learned later that the distinguished specialist my family called at once had declared the right eye was lost and must be removed. As soon as they could, they would do the necessary surgery. As for the left eye, there was little doubt that it too was gone, since the blow had been so hard as to cause sympathetic ophthalmia. At any rate, the retina of the left eye had been badly torn. The next morning, they operated, and with success. I had become completely and permanently blind. I have thanked heaven for making me blind while I was still a child and not quite 8 years old. I bless my lot for practical reasons, first of all. The habits of a boy of 8 are not yet formed, either in body or in mind.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.